The Model Context Protocol, or MCP, is a simple plug-and-play solution for giving models access to thousands of external APIs in an easy and standardized way, which is both exciting and terrifying. So it's important to have a solid understanding of MCP if you are going to dive in. This video will cover the basics of LLM tool calling and why MCP came about, how you can experiment with MCP servers for free, how to test and debug MCP servers, and to finish, we'll look at how to create an MCP-enabled agent from scratch with monitoring and logging configured. You'll also learn how to roll your own free MCP server using an open API spec and the Speakeasy CLI. So let's start with learning about tool calling and the MCP origin story, which is what MCP servers are primarily built for. Tool calling provides models with a schema-defined list of functions they can request to be called by the client. Tools are passed to the model as structured metadata, with the model evaluating whether to use one or more tools on a per-message basis. If a tool is required, the LLM responds with a tool call response, which the client executes, then returns the result to the model for further processing. The LLM itself doesn't directly call the tool or ever connect to an MCP server. This cycle continues until either the model responds to the original prompt or the conversation is terminated by the agent. For example, if the number of allowed tool calls exceeds a certain threshold. So instead of writing code like this, with function calling boilerplate code in a vendor-specific format, code now looks like this, with the Postgres MCP server replacing the boilerplate code and an agent framework replacing the chat completion API. But tool calling can have disastrous consequences if unvetted code is used or data access and permissions aren't locked down, as the LLM essentially has the ability to call any tool it has access to. Now, MCP is important because it's basically standardized tool calling across the industry and simplified tooling configuration for agent developers. So now that you've got the big picture, let's explore how MCP works. To get a little more technical now, MCP is a client-server protocol using JSON RPC as the transport format. The protocol has two built-in transports: standard I/O, where the agent runs the server and communicates using process input and output, and server sent events, where the agent connects over HTTP with streaming support. You'll almost always use standard I/O unless you require streaming or you're connecting to an external MCP server. Now, the context in MCP stems from its stateful nature, where a client creates an isolated and persistent connection with a server, so things like credentials and other contextual data are localized to that session. To illustrate how MCP works in practice, let's use a simple example. First, the user sends a prompt to the agent, with the agent retrieving the available tools from the MCP server. The agent then sends the prompt and tools list to the model. The model then responds with a tool call that the agent relays to the MCP server. The MCP server then executes the request against the external API resource, returning the result to the agent, who then forwards it to the model. And after processing the data from the tool call, the model is able to respond to the user's initial prompt. So that's the MCP theory out of the way. So now let's get into the first of three demos, starting with Claude and a Discord MCP server. I'll be using Claude from Anthropic, the creators of MCP, as it's the easiest and free way to experiment with MCP servers. I'll be using the Discord MCP server created using Speakeasy as part of the Discord TypeScript SDK. But you can also create a standalone MCP server in a new repository with the Speakeasy quick start command. The MCP server is almost entirely auto-generated thanks to the Speakeasy run command that uses the official Discord API spec. The instructions to run the Discord MCP server are taken from the README, and I'll use NPX to run the server as I've got Node.js installed. To give you a quick rundown of the Discord MCP server's capabilities, let's start with the help text from the MCP start command. And yes, I definitely copied and pasted that because I'm not great at typing. Okay, so the most important thing that I want to call attention to here is that the MCP server allows us to restrict tools sent to the client in one of two ways, or in two ways actually. We can either use a scope, which is normally scoped to a particular resource or the type of operation it is, for example, read or write. So if I wanted to restrict the MCP server to only doing read-only operations for guild resources, it would be the scope guilds and scope read. And if I wanted to get even more granular than that, I can use the tool flag and then supply the name of a specific tool, such as guilds, channels, list, I believe it is. So yeah, that's one really awesome and important feature of the MCP server. And then the other thing that we'll need is the bot token so we can authenticate against Discord's API. So to configure Claude to use the MCP server, we need to go to settings, then developer, click edit config, and then this just takes us to where the config file is stored on our machine. Then in VS Code, we just need to add the MCP server configuration. And for my use case, I just want Claude to be able to keep me updated on the latest that's going on in the Discord servers that I'm a part of. And so all I need for that is the ability to read, obviously, and the resources for users, guilds, channels, and messages, and of course, the bot token as well. With that, we can close. We can restart Claude. Okay, and then we can verify that it is talking to our MCP server by clicking the Search and Tools button, and we click on Discord, and we can see that all our required tools are there. Also, I like to use extended thinking, as I think it just helps the model do a better job to better utilize the tools that it has access to. Now it's time to get into a bit of a test. So I'll go to my notes here to grab the prompt. And the prompt is, what are the latest Andor related messages from the Star Wars Discord Guild in the show discussions channel? So I really like this conversational UI that Claude has, where you can see how it's thinking. So it's used the users list guilds to get the guild ID that it can access. Then it's getting the list of channels. Looks like it's found the channel that it needs. And now it's listing out all of the messages that I'm interested in, which were the ones that mention Andor. So let's now dive a bit deeper into how MCP works by using a tool called MCP Inspector. MCP Inspector is run using NPX, and as its single argument, just takes the command to run the MCP server you want to interact with. And then once it's started up on localhost, I'll go to my saved Chrome application, and here it's just populated the command and the arguments. So we can then click connect. Now up the top here, we've got all of the available resources, and like most MCP servers, that's just tools. So we can list all of the tools for this MCP server. And what I really like about Inspector is that you can also see the communication happening between Inspector, which is acting as the MCP client, and the MCP server you're working with. So for instance, I can look at the tools list call and see the response of all of the tools. So the way that you can use this to debug an MCP server is you simply click on the tool, and then you may have to supply parameters, but in this case, I can just click run tool, and it'll make that tool call and show me the data that the MCP server returned. Now, if you're working with other MCP servers, you might see a form view, but for the Discord MCP server and other MCP servers out there, often they require a request object. So if you need to debug, well, you need to find out what that request schema is. Now, the way that you can do this is if you go down to tools list and copy the response, then you can go to your favorite editor. You can throw this in. Then you can look for the tool that you want to debug. So that'll be guilds, list channels. And then I can scroll down to actually see the request object that it needs. So it needs a guild ID and a value, which is a string. All right, so if I head back to the MCP inspector, I can search for guilds, list channels. Okay, format JSON, which is good. I need guild ID. And the actual guild ID I can get from Discord. Put that value in. And now I can get the response from that particular tool. For the final demo, we'll take a look at the code for an MCP-enabled agent complete with monitoring and debugging. Now, I won't have time to go through, you know, how all of this works. I just want to touch on the most important pieces. Now, obviously, you'll need to decide on the agent framework you'll use. I'm using Pydantic AI here, along with Pydantic's Logfire, which is their logging and monitoring solution. And I chose those two just because they instrument things really nicely, which is good for a demo. And I must say, I found the Pydantic AI stuff really easy to use. Now, you'll need a way to configure things and provide secrets. So I'm using .env, but I'm also going to show you how to use Doppler, which is a way to inject secrets into the running agent as environment variables, so you don't then need to have a .env file on disk. So obviously, if you're building an agent that uses MCP servers, there needs to be a way to load that configuration in. So what I've got here is a system that uses an MCP config file, and it literally uses the same format that Claude does with one minor improvement, and that is that you can use environment variable substitution so you don't have to hard code your credentials into this file. Then if we go down to main, which is where everything starts, we get an instance of the agent from the initialize agent method. And this will configure and instrument Logfire if the Logfire token exists. Then it grabs the list of MCP servers, configures an instance of an OpenAI model, and then creates the agent by giving it a name, assigning it the model and the MCP servers, and an optional system prompt. Then that agent is returned to main, and then we pass it into the chat method. And this is where it just creates an endless loop until we decide to exit out. So we'll close down Inspector. And then this is what I was talking about using Doppler run to then run agent.py. It's really cool that in this console, you can see when the LLM is thinking and then when it's opting to use tools. Seems to be doing well. A single call to messages list means that it's found the show discussions channel, and now it's grabbing that list of messages and searching through to find the ones that are and or related. And here we can see quite a comprehensive and nicely formatted list of all of the and or related discussions. Heading over to Logfire, we can take a look at the logs that it recorded for that conversation. And just scrolling up to the top here. So here we can see the system prompt, the prompt from our agent, and then the sequence of events, which was the first list guilds tool call, then getting the list of channels, then getting the list of messages, so the model could then prepare its final response. Now, one thing that you may have noticed is that while MCP is amazing and very flexible and powerful, it can also be very token heavy. And so if you're supplying the API key for your MCP usage, just bear in mind that the cost can add up quickly because the amount of data can be quite significant. So while not quite as flexible and powerful as this UI here, another way that you can get visibility into your agent's behavior is looking at the completion logs from the OpenAI dashboard, presuming, of course, obviously you're using an OpenAI model. So here we can see a very simple view of, once again, the sequence of events of the system prompt, the user, and the tool calls until we get to the agent's response. As you've just seen, it's relatively straightforward to create an agent from scratch that can utilize MCP servers, as well as having solutions for logging and monitoring. Hopefully that last demo helped kind of bring everything together, and that as a result of watching this video, you now feel like you've got a good understanding of how MCP really works. I'm Ryan Blunden, and I hope you enjoyed the video.